Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's Science of Sleep Facebook Q&A. My name is Dr. Marishka Brown, and I'm the director of the National Center on Sleep Disorders Research at the Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute. The Science of Sleep series is a three-part series designed to explore NIH research on the impact of sleep on our health at every age. It is co-hosted by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, the Eunice Kennedy Shriver National Institute on Child Health and Development, and the National Institute on Aging. Our topic for today is sleep health in middle-aged adults, and it's my pleasure to be joined today by Dr. Phillip Cheng, who will be answering your questions. Dr. Cheng is an assistant scientist at the Thomas Roth Sleep Disorders and Research Center at Henry Ford Health Systems in Detroit, Michigan. Dr. Cheng is a clinical psychologist with expertise in sleep and circadian medicine, particularly with respect to shift work disorders and insomnia. He is interested in sleep and circadian medicine because of the wide-reaching impact on mental health, physical health, safety, and quality of life. Today, Dr. Cheng will be sharing his expertise on sleep issues in middle-aged adults. Dr. Cheng?
Thank you, Marishka. It is always a pleasure to see you and speak with you, and I'm quite excited to be here to talk about the science of sleep and to share some of my research and our insights around sleep health.
Fantastic. So before we get started, I want to let everyone know that we will be sharing resources and links on Facebook throughout today's conversation. I also want to be clear that the information given or discussed is not medical advice. We are sharing insights from the latest research as well as resources on this topic. If you need medical advice, please speak to your medical provider. As this is a quick Q&A, let's get to it. So Dr. Cheng, the Science of Sleep series has been discussing sleep across the lifespan. Last week, we focused on sleep in children and teens. So can you give us a little bit more insight on sleep health issues among middle-aged adults? Are there particular risk factors for sleep issues in this population?
Absolutely. And I'm really glad you used the term risk factors. Before I dive in, I'll just say that oftentimes there's a misconception that sleep problems are normative with aging. And I just want to say that it's not the case, although with many misconceptions, there is a nugget of truth. And I would say that the nugget of truth in that misconception is that there are just some normative things that change with aging that do increase risk factors for a range of sleep difficulties and disorders. But at the end of the day, those are still disorders and do still warrant medical and clinical attention. So sleep issues do tend to occur, but when they are disorders, they are problems that need to get taken care of. So one of those issues is normative changes in just our sleep system and our circadian rhythms, and that can increase risk for insomnia, for example. One of the other things that can happen is we can also see increases in risk factors for insomnia. So stress is certainly a big part of that. And as we get into middle age, there can be specific developmental challenges that can happen, for example, marital issues, divorce, and sometimes physiological issues like going through perimenopause, for example. And these are all things that can increase our risk factors for insomnia specifically. Another thing that can happen is as our circadian rhythms age, along with our other physiological systems, we sometimes see shift workers start to also start to develop difficulties with the night shift schedule. And that in particular can be very problematic, especially as we are going into another surge in COVID-19 patients and, you know, needing around-the-clock care. We really want to be able to take care of our shift workers as well. And then just commonly with aging, we see that medical conditions start to come up. And of course, that comes with taking medications, and all of these can also increase our risk for sleep problems. As we know, sleep is something that really is affected by and affects multiple domains of our lives. And so with the development of medical conditions, we may see deterioration of sleep as well.
So, okay, to be fair, we're talking about a huge group of people when we say middle-aged Americans or middle-aged adults. So really, that's a lot of different people covering a lot of different life events, both biological and social, some you just mentioned. And so what does the research tell us about the sleep health of these various middle-aged populations?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I would say there are certainly certain demographics that are going to be, for one reason or another, more at risk for sleep problems as they enter the sort of large swath of time that we call middle age. I did talk about women earlier. I would say that women in particular, because of the perimenopause that can happen in the middle age range, that can increase risk for insomnia, like I mentioned. But one problem that has been under-recognized so far until recently is sleep apnea. So until recently, many doctors would have viewed or seen sleep apnea as mostly a male disease. And that has resulted in many more men than women getting diagnosed with obstructive sleep apnea. But the emerging studies now show that sleep apnea in women is likely to be underestimated and undertreated, as are signs and symptoms of sleep apnea in premenopausal women. And these signs can be very different compared to men. And so that's a demographic that we want to be especially thoughtful of as we learn more about them. Another area thinking about women and sleep is pregnancy. So pregnant women often suffer from sleep disordered breathing, particular sleep apnea, and they often are at higher risk for both gestational diabetes and hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. And these are leading causes of maternal illness and death worldwide. So another reason for why we really want to be thinking about women's health. And then I will also say something that has been quite prevalent and highlighted during the COVID-19 pandemic are just marginalized individuals. We are now seeing more and more that there are racial disparities in sleep health. And these disparities can be magnified when marginalized individuals start to develop comorbidities or just morbidities in general and start to see sleep health declining, and the bi-directional relationship of that can further widen the health disparity gaps. And you know, we've already seen this in COVID-19, not just with the diagnosis or infection rates that are much higher in Black Americans, for example, as well as other marginalized individuals, but also that the consequences of COVID-19, even if it isn't infection, but rather, for example, quarantine or loss of job and loss of wages, these all contribute to health and sleep health.
Phillip, thank you so much. That was some great information, particularly around the health of women, shift workers, and disparities broadly, SES, socioeconomic status, as well as racial ethnic minorities. So much of your research explores the intersection between sleep and mental health among middle-aged adults, particularly in the space of insomnia and shift work. So how do these relate to one another?
Absolutely. Insomnia and just in general, poor sleep really affects how well you can think, how well you can respond to stress, so things like reacting to the way people are talking to you or just small stressors, daily stressors, how you work, your ability to think clearly, your ability to learn, even if you're someone who's in school or learning the ropes of a new profession, for example, and even just things like how well you can get along with others that have ramifications for how you're perceived and whether or not you are provided further opportunities for growth at your place of employment, for example. Now, scientists are still trying to tease apart all of the mechanisms that go from poor sleep health to these large and important outcomes that we care about. But we have discovered that sleep disruption, in particular, is important because it affects a lot of different aspects of human functioning, down to the level of neurotransmitters and stress hormones, among other things that can really just wreak havoc in the brain and can impair our ability to think, to regulate our emotions. And insomnia in particular can amplify these mechanisms to really increase our risk for psychiatric disorders. Now, we've known for a long time that insomnia disorder is almost like a gateway disorder. It can really increase robustly our risk for psychiatric problems, depression being one of the most well-documented areas. And so not only is insomnia highly comorbid with depression, we also have seen over the years of research that when we treat the depression, the insomnia may not necessarily go away. And when you have lingering insomnia, it really puts us at much higher risk to relapse in terms of our depression. It shortens the time between episodes of depression, and it also worsens our depression or our trajectory of depression. And so all of these things point to how important it is to take care of our sleep. And I'll say some of our more recent studies have shown that when we treat insomnia and we follow these people over time, that those who got treatment compared to those who did not get an effective treatment are doing much better. And in particular, there's a study that we published recently looking at how people are doing during COVID-19 in particular. And people who got an active treatment compared to a control treatment were just doing much better. They had much less stress, they had less insomnia, of course, but also less depression, and reported better global health.
Wow, that's amazing, Phillip. Like, be able to be treated pre-pandemic and be able to sustain that throughout. So one of the things that I find fascinating about sleep as a science is that it's both behavior as well as underlying physiology. And so since our behaviors can impact sleep health, what are a few examples of things that can be done to actually improve your sleep?
Absolutely. That's a great question. I'll start off by saying that the way I'll answer that is essentially about sleep hygiene, which is a set of behaviors that are good for your sleep health. Whenever I talk about sleep hygiene, I like to emphasize that sleep hygiene alone is not an effective treatment for sleep disorders. So if you suspect that you may have insomnia or know that you have insomnia, just know that these behaviors by themselves are necessary but not sufficient in treating your symptoms. I sometimes like to use the analogy that if you have an infection, keeping the infections clean is of course important, but depending on how bad the infection is, you need treatment and not just cleaning. So some of the things that we value in terms of behaviors for healthy sleep are things like regularity of sleep, meaning going to bed at around the same time every day, waking up at around the same time, getting enough sleep. So there's now consensus evidence or consensus among the sleep community that for adults, you want to be somewhere between 7 to 9 hours. Sometimes people have that magic 8 number in their minds, but 7 to 9 is sort of where we think people should be at. And watching what you're having before sleep, so things like avoiding caffeine, alcohol, making sure you're not getting too much light, that's been a very popular area, especially thinking about blue light. And of course, physical activity and watching your stress, that those can be very important things to think about.
Thank you so much for that, Philip. And time certainly flies when you're having fun. We are at time. So that is it for us today. Thank you, everyone who joined us. And thank you very much, Dr. Cheng, for highlighting the important aspects about the science of sleep for middle-aged adults. And so for more information and resources about the Science of Sleep series, please visit www.nia.nih.gov. / science of sleep. You can also continue this conversation online using the hashtag science of sleep. Thank you very much, everyone, and we will see you next week.
Take care, everyone.